Dear students, are you hearing my voice? Right. So, in the yesterday's class, we had a glance over the constitutional developments from 1773 onwards. You are well aware that many constitutional developments has taken place up to 1946. Then a constitutional assembly has started, and the constitutional assembly had several committees to prepare a constitution for India. Okay, so among the committees, drafting committees were among them, and as a head of the drafting committee, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. His contribution nearly up to 3 years takes, and finally made a bigger constitution, which certain provisions has taken from other countries of the world, and also the majority of the provisions which from the constitutional reforms which taken place during the time of British India. Okay, so we had a glance over these constitutional developments up to Government Act of 1858 in the last class. Okay, so today I will give you certain detailed manner of every constitutional development. And I will start with the Regulating Act of 1773. This is the first constitutional development in British India. Okay, so you are well aware that the territorial acquisitions of East India Company produced a starting effect in England, and the public in general clamored as an immediate parliamentary intervention. Two parliamentary committees were appointed to inquire into the affairs of East India Company. So the servants of East India Company were concentrating on the private trade, and the trade of company was being neglected. The company has almost forgotten about the trade, and progressively thinking in terms of conquering more and more land. This needed large armies more expenditure. And in the context of changing the texture of the company, the employees of the company, East India Company, were given low salaries, but they were allowed to carry a private trade, and the result was that the employees concentrated on their private trade and became rich, and the company's trade started dwindling. Okay, it's gradually decreasing. So, and at the same time, you can see certain pitiable condition of the people. The guiding principle for the employees of company was to take money, and the effect of this anarchical tendency was that people of India suffered the entire suffering, the famine of 1770 and other certain famines has taken place during the time, and further aggravated the situation the people started groaning aloud. Okay, so when you see, you have certain defective dual government in Bengal, where Diwani in one side and another one, another thing is another side. Okay, so when you see the defective dual government in Bengal, during the famine of 1770, grains were hoarded by the company's employees and they exploited the situation to the fullest extent and sold them at staggering prices. And obviously the servants of the company became rich as they wanted, but the people were completely broke. And then Clive's experiment of dual government is Bengal brought havoc. Okay, so when you see certain provisions in the Regulating Act, which is one of the initial constitutional reform which started in India basically. Okay, so when you see its provisions, yesterday we discussed one or two things and we will see certain 10 manner put. So the Governor of Bengal was made the Governor General, and the entire civil and military administration of Bengal was given to the Governor General, and the provision was made for an executive council of 4 members to assist the help of the governor. Okay, so one executive council, which executive council, which is a setup started first time to assist the Governor General. Okay, so the Governor General is a governor, Governor of Bengal, which turned into Governor General of Bengal. Okay, so the act mentioned the names of first Governor General and the members of executive council, and it said Warren Hastings would be the first Governor General of Bengal, you are aware, and the 4 executive councillors mentioned in the act were Philip Francis, Clavering, Monsoon and Barber. Okay, so these are the 4 important members in the executive council. One is the Philip Francis, Clavering, Monsoon and Barber. Okay, so with these 4 members the executive council was started. Okay, so their term of office was 5 years, but they could be removed from office earlier by the British monarch if the court of directors recommended such an action. If the court of directors recommended to terminate any member in the executive council, it may fall. Okay, so the Governor General could not take a decision on any matter independently. He had to act on the advice of the councillors. Decisions were taken in the council by major vote. Okay, so in the case of tie, the Governor General was given a casting vote, but he could not overrule his council. Okay, so the presidencies of Madras and Bombay were made subordinate to Bengal, and these both Bengal and Bombay and Madras, which is comes under the jurisdiction of this Governor General of Bengal, and the Governor Sindh Council of Bombay and Madras had to follow the instructions of Governor General in Council, and the Governor General could direct, control and superintend the 2 presidencies, and these two presidencies could neither declare war on war nor conclude peace with any power without the sanction of Governor General Council. Okay, so without prior permission of Governor General Council, no governor of Madras or Bombay had no right to declare war or conclude peace with anyone. Okay, it means what? The whole presidencies of Madras and Bengal, sorry, Madras and Bombay both comes under this Governor General of Bengal. Okay, so in the jurisdiction of Governor General of Bengal, and the employees of the company were forbidden to accept any bribes or gifts from anybody. And if it was a serious matter, they could be sent back to England as a matter of action. If any employee of a East India Company offered or get any gift from anyone, if it is proved, he may send to England again as a punishment. Okay. So, and the Governor General in Council could make rules and regulations and issue ordinances for the good government of the company's secretaries. These rules, regulations and advice were to be registered with the Supreme Court of India, which was created by the Act. Without registration, these rules and regulations had no effect or meaning. Okay, so these are such important provisions. And one more, another provision from Regulating Act of 1773 is that a Supreme Court was established by Regulating Act. Okay, the Supreme Court was given jurisdiction over the British subjects like subjects living in Bengal, Bihar, Odisha, and the Supreme Court was empowered to try ecclesial and admiralty, civil and criminal cases. And the case was decided on the basis of judgment by the jury. The Supreme Court had original as well as appellate jurisdiction. The Supreme Court was to be a court of record. Any contempt or disrespect shown to its orders would be a punishable offense. Okay, so the Supreme Court at Bengal was set up according to the Regulating Act of 1773. And the Governor General, the members of Executive Council, the judges, collectors and inspectors, their agents or servants, all were forbidden to carry on private trade of any description. No gift could be accepted by these officers from Indian princes or the people. Okay, so no official could get any gift from anyone. And provisions for home authorities. When you see this Regulating Act also provided certain provisions for the home authorities. And before the passage of this Regulating Act, the directors of the company were elected for a short term of 1 year. And directors of the company were elected by the Court of Proprietors. And the system was extremely defective. And the directors were busy throughout their term or 1 year, either obliging their supporters of the previous election or preparing others for the coming election. Okay, so the Regulating Act did a good job by making the Court of Directors as a permanent one. Okay, so no term of years, no duration for this Court of Directors. Okay, so the Court of Directors made a permanent one. And the Act, the Regulating Act, required the Governor General of Bengal and the Governor of Presidencies of Bombay, Madras to pay due obedience to the orders of the directors in London. It was the first measure by which a European government assumed the responsibility for governing territories acquired by it outside Europe and inhabited by civilized people. The Act also contemplated to eradicate corruption and bribery by making several provisions. One among them was the establishment of Supreme Court. This court could punish offenders. Acceptance of a gifts and presents was forbidden. Okay. So when you see certain demerits of this act, regulating act. One is these are certain positive things from this regulating act of 1773. When you see certain negative things like defects, defects of the act, the regulating act was full of grave defects. The jurisdiction and power of the Supreme Court were not properly defined, and the results were very ugly. One often witnessed dirty conflicts of jurisdiction between the Supreme Court and courts of Calcutta. And the regulating act did not specify the jurisdiction and power of Governor General in council or the judges of the Supreme Court. And the relations between the Supreme Court and other courts of the company were not specified. And the presidencies of Madras and Bombay were subordinate to the Bengal, and the Governor General in Council was given power to superintend and control the management and government of two presidencies. Okay, so and one more defect from this act was no veto power to the Governor General. Okay, so the act granted no veto power to the Governor General. He was to act according to the advice of the majority in the council, executive council. Since he could not veto the decision of these councillors, he was thus powerless before his colleagues. We know that till up to 1778, Warren Hastings was invariably outvoted and overruled by the majority of the councillors who were against him. Consequently, Warren Hastings had a difficult time when he came face to face with his councillors. Okay, so and when you see certain other councils, other provisions of this regulating act, no supreme legislative authority has provided. Okay, so the act provided no supreme legislative authority nearer than the England to mediate in the dispute of these two bodies and to mark the proper sphere of the executive and the judicial departments. And the vagueness of the clauses was further increased owing to the fact that regulations of Bengal made by the council were subject to the court. Okay, so and when you see the other provision, like the parliament, parliamentary control over the company was also insufficient. Okay, so the act no doubt provided that copies of the all civil and military dispatches received by the directors from governor in council in India were to be forwarded within a fortnight to certain members of the English ministry. But it set up no effective machinery to study and scrutinize those reports. Thus, the parliamentary control over the company was ineffective. Okay, so these are certain provisions and certain advantages and disadvantages and certain defects for regulating act of 1773. After the 1773, there is another important act which is came into the force. Is nothing but the amending act of 1781. Okay, so the amending act is nothing but certain amendments has started, certain amendments has followed by the act of charter act of 1770. Okay, so certain provisions as added to the regulating act of 1770. Okay, we'll see one or two points. it was released the Amending Act of 1771, okay, which is certain amendments which made in the Regulating Act of 1773. And it was admitted on all hands that there were many shortcomings in the Regulating Act, and consequently an act was passed in 1781 to remove them. A new act provided that the public servants of company were not to be subject to the jurisdiction of Supreme Court for things done by them in their official capacity. Okay, so revenue collectors and judicial officers of the company, courts were also exempted from the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. Okay, so for things done by them in their official capacity, and the Governor General and the members of the council were also exempted from the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, both individually and collectively, for anything council ordered or done by them in their public capacity. Okay, so and the servants of the company, when you see the added provisions in the Regulating Act, which is added through the Act of 1781, servants of the company were to be subject to the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court for the wrongs done by them on trespass, and cases could be brought before the Supreme Court by the agreement of both the parties. In seas relating to inheritance or succession to lands or goods, the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court was excluded. The Supreme Court was required to take into consideration and respect the religious and social customs and usages of the Indian while enforcing the decrees and the process. Okay. So, and see another one is that Governor General in Council was given the power to make regulations for the provisional courts and councils. Formally, the rules and regulations made by the Governor General were required to be registered with the Supreme Court. This led to a lot of inconvenience. Consequently, the Act of 1781, the Enactment Act of 1781, provided that no such registration was required. The Act provided that appeals were to be taken from the provisional courts to the Governor General in Council. Okay, so and after that, the year 1781 marks the most important era in the history now under the Constitution. It terminated a period of fierce anonymity and the struggle between those wishing to see English laws and courts of justice introduced at once into the country and render supreme over the executive, and those who considered that such a policy was wholly impracticable and that circumstanced as a English, then our government must be a long time to come control the authority of the courts. Okay, so in the year 1781, may therefore well be taken as a first dividing point of time at which the charter of that history essentially changes, at which boundaries of authority have at last become strongly defined. Okay, so this is the first the provisions of Charter Act of 1773, and after Charter Act of 1773, another most important act in the history of constitutional India, which is the Pitt's India Act of 1784. Okay, so it is in 1784, the younger, the Prime Minister of England, soon after the assumption of his introduction, which is a bill for letter control of the Indian administration by England. The bill was passed and came to be known as the Pitt's India Act. Okay. So because the act was passed by the younger Pitt, then the Prime Minister of India. Okay, that's why we call it as the Pitt's India Act. And There were many causes responsible for passage of this act. Okay, so one main cause is in the Regulating Act of 1773. There were many glaring defects which were necessary to be reformed by the British Parliament if the administration of the company was to run on some ground, some sound footing in India. Okay, so certain defects found in the Regulating Act of 1773 to fulfill those gaps or those defects, to revise those defects, and this Regulating Act was passed. And the second cause is in 1783, the different American colonies became quite independent of the British colony, and naturally English were worried that such an example would be followed by India. Okay, so you are well aware that 1783 many colonies in the American continent which became independent. Okay, so if it will be happening in England, in India, it may be somewhat problem to England. Okay, so it was thought proper to exercise more control over the affairs of the East India Company in India. When you see the main provisions in the Regulating Act, the political and commercial activities of company were now separated. Okay, so political and commercial. Okay, trade and politics is separated. Okay, so and the commercial functions were allowed to be performed by board of directors. Commercial functions, trade and commerce, which is functioned by the performed by the board of directors, but for the supervision, board direction and control of Indian government, a board of control was set up in India. Okay, so here board of directors will see about the commercial functions, and Bombay and Madras were now definitely subordinated by the Governor General and his council, and act provided for the establishment of a separate board for the better trial of the company's officials in England for offenses committed by them in India. Okay, so when Warren Hastings fought many undesired wars, so in order to prevent the succeeding Governor General from copying the examples of Warren Hastings, the act laid down the henceforth the Governor General from which is laid down that henceforth the Governor General should take the permission of the Board of Control before making peace or delaying any war. Okay, so thus the Pitt's India Act, Board of Control before making peace or declaring any war. Thus, the Pitt's India Act laid emphasis on the policy of this non-intervention. Okay, so when you see the importance of this Regulating Act, Pitt's India Act. Pitt's India Act is a quite an important legislation because it the real power in India passed to the directors, to the British Parliament. The Board of Directors now remained as a mere shadow of its former existence. In actual practice, the Board of Control appointed by the British Parliament came to supersede both the Court of Proprietors, proprietors, and the Board of Directors, and it could inspect the files of the company and issue instructions accordingly with the directors of company had to carry out. Okay, so moreover, the Pitt's India Act proved the quite permanent and underwent little material changes till 1858. In that year, some changes were no doubt made as a result of the great rising of 1857, but still it is fundamental principle remain almost all the same. Okay, so when If you see another charter act which is followed by Pissinger Act, which is the Charter Act of 1793. Okay, so the East India Company was given a new charter in 1773. The Act of 1773 is a very long one, and the repeated many old laws and consolidating existing one. However, it did not make any alterations. When you see certain provisions of the Charter Act of 1793, the Governor General and the Governor were given the powers to override their councils, and the power had given specially to the Cornwallis in 1786. The control of the Governor General over the Presidency of Madras and Bombay and was insisted, and it was laid down that when the Governor General went to a presidency, she superseded a governor. Okay, so Governor General was given the power to appoint Vice President of his executive council from the members of the council, and the Vice President was to act in the place of Governor General when the latter was absent from the bench. And the Governor and the Commander-in-Chief was not to be a member of the Council of the Governor General unless he was especially appointed to be a member by the Court of Directors. And the Admiral jurisdiction of Kolkata, Supreme Court was extended to his high areas, and it was provided that the payment of the members and the staff of the Board of Directors, Board of Control, staff of the Board of Control should be made out of the Indian revenues, and this system continued up to the 1990. Okay, it is continued up to 1990. And it was provided that the two junior members of Board of Control need to be privy councillors. Okay, so and the charter of the company was renewed for 20 years, which is renewed for 20 years. Okay, so these are the things about Charter Act of 1793. And when you see Charter Act of 1813, since this act was operative for 20 years up to 1993. Okay, so 1893, right? So the British Parliament passed the Charter Act 1813, the act operative for 20 years, that is up to 1833, okay, 1833. And the British Parliament passed the Charter Act of 1813 was an improvement upon the previous Charter Act of 1793. Okay, so every Charter Act is passed for 20 years, every 20 years, no? You are well aware. So the main provisions of this act, the provisions of when you see the provisions of 1813 Charter Act, and in its essential provisions, the powers of Board of Control to superintend, control and direct the affairs of India were clearly defined and greatly enlarged, and the company's powers of patronage were reduced, and the Court of Directors were to make appointments to the Office of Governor General and Commander-in-Chief, Governor, etc., subject to the approval of the King of England, and their orders to this effect had been countered similarly by the Board of Control. Okay, so no changes were made in company's constitution and the grant of its territorial acquisition. in India with attended revenues were extended for another 20 years. The British Crown's sovereignty over the company's territorial acquisition was explicitly proclaimed. And the most important provision was concerned with the trade, and the company's tea trade, trade of tea with China was reserved for it. But trade monopoly with India was completely abolished, and the private merchants of the England were permitted to develop free trading contact with India, and the British merchants and the missionaries were given full liberty to settle in India after securing license from the purpose from the directors of the company. And the company was required to appoint one bishop at Calcutta with three archdeacons to work under. Okay. So this is when you see certain significance of Charter Act of 1833. And after completion of 1813, we'll see Charter Act of 1833 and 53 and Government Act of 1858 in the tomorrow's class. Okay, we'll end up with the significance of Charter Act of 1813. Okay, so 1813. So they clearly proclaimed the sovereignty of the crown over the company's territories in India, and the powers of the board of control being considerably enlarged. And the abolition of company's trade monopoly was not of less significance. British private merchants were allowed to go settle in India, and thus to introduce a severe competition in trade, which was prior to this entire in the company's hands. Okay. So the Christian missionaries of England were allowed to come freely and settle in this country, and this had wholesome effect in a sense that a large number of missionary schools and colleges were opened for education of the Indians. Okay. So, and the provisions for setting apart 1 lakh of rupees for the development of education in India was welcome government. Okay. So, and it's laid the foundation of the English system of education in India, which through open progressive English literature on liberty and equality for the Indian mind to inculcate. Okay. So these are certain important things regarding the Charter Act of 1813. And there are other things to be known from Charter Act of 1833. Okay, so tomorrow we'll see about the Charter Act of 1833 and Charter Act of 1853 and Government India Act of 1858 in the tomorrow's class in detail. Okay, so students, are you hearing? Vinthistunna? వెంకటమ్మ శ్రీ విద్య
వినిపిస్తుంది సార్.
ఓకే, సో ఇది ఏదైతే ఈ రోజుకి సంబంధించి అంటే మనకు సిలబస్ లో భాగంగా చెప్పుకునేటటువంటి ఏవైతే కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ డెవలప్మెంట్స్ ఉన్నాయో, అంటే కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ ఇండియా అనేటటువంటిది ఎప్పుడైతే 1949లో రూపుదిద్దుకున్నటువంటిది, సో అప్పటి వరకు కూడా ఏదైతే రకరకాలైనటువంటి కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ డెవలప్మెంట్స్ అంటూ జరుగుతూ వచ్చాయి, అవి బ్రిటిష్ ఇండియా కాలం నుంచి కూడా మనకు కనిపిస్తూ ఉంటాయి అన్నమాట. ఓకే, సో అవి మీకు తెలుసు 1857 రివోల్ట్స్ కంటే ముందు ఈస్ట్ ఇండియా కంపెనీ రూల్ కనిపించేది, సో ఈస్ట్ ఇండియా కంపెనీ టైంలోనే ఒక రకమైనటువంటి ఈ రిఫార్మ్స్ తేవటం అనేటటువంటి మొదలుపెట్టారు. క్రమక్రమంగా ఏదైతే ఈస్ట్ ఇండియా కంపెనీ యొక్క ఆధిపత్యాన్ని తగ్గించేటటువంటి క్రమం, సో అందులో భాగంగానే ఏదైతే గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా 1858 యాక్ట్ వచ్చేంతవరకు మనకున్నటువంటి ఏదైతే అంతవరకు వచ్చినటువంటి ఆ రిఫార్మ్స్ గురించి మనం మాట్లాడుకుంటాం. అందులో భాగంగా ఈరోజు చెప్పుకున్న మూడు యాక్ట్లు అన్నమాట. ఓకే, సో చార్టర్ యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ 1773 రెగ్యులేటింగ్ యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ 1773 అండ్ ఫిట్స్ ఇండియా యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ 1784 అండ్ చార్టర్ యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ 1813 ఓకే, సో 33 వరకు మనం చూపుకోలేదు. ఒక 33 అండ్ 53 అండ్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా యాక్ట్ 1858 రేపటి క్లాస్లో చూపారు. ఇప్పుడు ఈరోజు చెప్తున్నటువంటి మూడే యాక్ట్లు, రెగ్యులేటింగ్ యాక్ట్, చార్టర్ యాక్ట్ 1773, ఫిట్స్ ఇండియా యాక్ట్, అట్లనే చార్టర్ యాక్ట్ ఆఫ్ 1830. ఓకే, సో ఈ మూడు యాక్ట్ల గురించి మనం మాట్లాడుకున్నాం, అందులో ఉన్నటువంటి ప్రొవిజన్స్ గురించి మనం మాట్లాడుకున్నాం. ఓకే, సో రేపు మిగతా యాక్ట్లు అదే 1858 యాక్ట్ వరకు మనం రేపు మాట్లాడుకుంటాం. ఓకే, సో ఇది మన సిలబస్లో ఉన్నటువంటి ఏదైతే ఫస్ట్ మాడ్యూల్లో ఉన్నటువంటి అంశాలని మనం 1 by 1 ఆర్డర్లో చూసుకుంటూ వెళ్ళాం. ఈ ఫస్ట్ మాడ్యూల్ ఏదైతే ఈ కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ హిస్టరీ ఆఫ్ ఇండియాలో ఫస్ట్ మాడ్యూల్ కంప్లీట్ అయిపోయిన తర్వాత ఏదైతే ఉమెన్స్ హిస్టరీ మీకు ఉన్నదో, హిస్టరీ ఆఫ్ ఉమెన్ స్టడీస్ ఏదైతే ఉన్నదో, ఫోర్త్ పేపర్ సారీ ఫిఫ్త్ పేపర్ అది, అందులో ఒక ఫస్ట్ యూనిట్ కంప్లీట్ చేసుకుంటాం. ఓకే, సో ఆల్రెడీ ట్రైబల్ అండ్ పీజెంట్ రివోల్ట్స్కి సంబంధించినటువంటి అంశాలు చూసినా ఫస్ట్ యూనిట్, అట్లనే ఇక్కడ ఫస్ట్ యూనిట్ చూస్తాం, అట్లనే ఏదైతే ఉమెన్ స్టడీస్ ఏదైతే ఉన్నదో ఆ ఉమెన్ స్టడీస్లో కూడా మనం ఒక ఫస్ట్ మాడ్యూల్ చూసి మళ్ళా ట్రైబల్ అండ్ పిజన్ మూమెంట్ సెకండ్ మాడ్యూల్ అట్లా వెళ్ళిపోతుంది. ఓకే, సో మీకు తెలుసు ఈ మూడు పేపర్లు నేనే డీల్ చేస్తున్నాను, ట్రైబల్ అండ్ పిజన్ రివోర్డ్స్, అట్లనే కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ హిస్టరీ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా, అట్లనే ఉమెన్ స్టడీస్ ఇన్ మోడర్న్ ఇండియా, రైట్. సో దీనికి సంబంధించి అంటే ఇప్పుడు మాట్లాడుకున్నటువంటి మూడు యాక్ట్లకు సంబంధించి ఏమన్నా మీకు డౌట్ ఉంటే మీరు అడగచ్చు. ఉన్నాయా ఏమన్నా డౌట్?
నో సార్.
ఓకే, ఫాలో అవుతున్నారా? ఇంకేమన్నా యాడ్ చేయాలా
సార్? ఆ 3 పేపర్స్ మళ్ళీ చెప్పండి సార్. ఏవి?
ట్రైబల్ అండ్ పిజెంట్ రివోల్ట్స్ ఇన్ 19th అండ్ 20th సెంచరీస్ పేపర్ 3, కాన్స్టిట్యూషనల్ హిస్టరీ ఆఫ్ ఇండియా పేపర్ 4A,
ఓకే ఇంకా సార్ లాస్ట్,
ఉమెన్ స్టడీస్ ఇన్ మోడర్న్ ఇండియా. ఓకే, సో మిగతా టీచర్స్ క్లాసెస్ తీసుకుంటున్నారా?
నో సార్, ఎవరు తీసుకోవట్లేదా మీరు?
నాగేశ్వర్ సార్ కానీ హరిశంకర్ సార్ కానీ ఏం తీసుకోవట్లేదు.
1 week అవుతుందేమో అప్పుడు తీసుకున్నారు అంతే, ఇంకా 1 week అంటే ఎక్కువనే కావచ్చు సార్, ఇంకా ఎప్పుడో ఒకసారి తీసుకుంటారు. ఇలా డైలీ అవుతుంటే ఒకసారి కాకుండా ఒకసారి అన్నా అటెండ్ అవుతాం సార్, ఇంకెప్పుడో ఒకసారి అయితే కాబట్టి ఇంకా ఒకసారి కూడా అటెండ్ కావడానికి కొద్దిగా ఇబ్బంది అవుతుంది.
ఇబ్బంది గురించి నేను అనట్లే, ఇప్పుడు మీకు గ్రూపుల్లోని అట్లీస్ట్ వాళ్ళు లింక్ సెండ్ చేస్తున్నారా లేదా?
చేస్తున్నారు సార్, అంటే క్లాస్ ఉన్నప్పుడు అయితే చేస్తున్నారు సార్.
ఎన్రోల్ అయింది క్లాస్ తీసుకోక వాళ్ళు? లాస్ట్ క్లాస్ ఎప్పుడు అటెండ్ అయ్యారు?
సార్ 1 week అయితే కావచ్చు సార్, 1 week అవుతుంది.
1 week నుంచి మీ క్లాస్ అటెండ్ కాలేదు వాళ్ళిద్దరు అంతే కదా?
ఇక అవుతుంది 7 days అయితే అవుతుంది.
లింక్ కూడా ఏం పంపించలేదు
అంటే క్లాస్ ఉన్నప్పుడు మాత్రం ఎప్పుడుందో ఆ రోజు మాత్రం పంపిస్తారు
సార్. 24th ఉండే సార్ క్లాస్, 24th రోజు.
24th కున్నారు సరే సరే ఓకే అమ్మ ఇక నేను క్లాస్ ఎండ్ చేస్తున్నాను డౌట్స్ ఉన్నాయా
ఏం లేదు సార్
రైట్ నా